Today I want to share briefly about an agent that has often been forgotten. This is a smart agent, a powerful agent. And how many of you have seen, you know, like a presidential entourage, and we have agents in those suits, you know, and when they got stuff, they are talking, you know, and, you know, those agents, you know, they are very smart. You know, they know stuff that you and I don't know. You know, they've been here before the president was here. They know stuff, you know. And I want to talk about an agent that we have, but that agent is not employed. He's not working. And we are busy doing our thing, and the agent is just looking at us. You know, I want to talk about the special agent, the Holy Spirit. Amen. Talk about the special agent, the Holy Spirit. How many of you would love to know what's coming tomorrow? How many of you would like to know that when I sleep, I can get some secrets about a situation? You know, how many of you know that there are people who appropriate spirits, witchcraft, to know your life, to know where you're going, you know, to disrupt your affairs? You know, they feel so powerful that they can, and they can know about your future. You know, we have in America those who are called palm readers. You know, they read your palm and they tell you, you know, next week this and this is going to happen. It's all in another realm, which is not the realm or the kingdom that we serve. We have the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit. And that's what I want to share in the next few minutes. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, thank you for your Holy Spirit. I invite your Holy Spirit, not because your Holy Spirit is not here. You are omnipresent, omnipotent, omniscient. You have been here, Holy Spirit. You are with us. But by inviting you, I'm just submitting myself to you. Come, Holy Spirit, have your way. Open yourself to your people in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Thank you for this moment. In Jesus' name, amen. Come, Holy Spirit, I need you. Come, sweet Spirit, in thy strength and thy power, just come in thy own gentle way. You got it. Oh, come, Holy Spirit, come, Zechariah chapter 4, verse 4 to 7. Zechariah chapter 4, verse 4 to 7. Amen. Just come in. Just come in thy own gentle way. Zechariah chapter 4, verse 4 to 7. The Bible says, then I say to the angel who was speaking with me, saying, what are these, my Lord? So the angel who was speaking with me answered and said to me, do you not know what these are? Thank you, sound man. Oh, that's not in the Bible. Don't look for it. And I said, no, my Lord. Then he said to me, this is the word of the Lord to Zerubbabel, saying, not by might nor by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord of hosts. What are you, O great mountain? Before Zerubbabel, you will become a plain, and he will bring forth the top stone with shouts of grace, grace to it all. And may the Lord bless the reading of his word. Amen. The Holy Spirit is one of the most underutilized. That means oftentimes as believers, we don't put the Holy Spirit to work. Or in some areas, abandoned aspect of Christian theology. For instance, there are the classical dispensationalists. It's a big word for those who are in theology. Dispensation just meaning times. You know, they believe, or rather we have in the Bible, the time when God talked and came down and met the people. That time ended, then we had Jesus come, walked on earth. That dispensation, that time went by, and then now we have the dispensation of the Holy Spirit, dispensation of grace, and that and all that. So we have some theologians who believe that the work of the Holy Spirit is to, you can have a seat and let's go ahead and enjoy the sermon, time to rest, right? Amen. Thank you. Give him a hand, everybody. Give him a hand. I see he's a diligent worker. He wants to keep working. So I give you leave. Leave, get some rest. Okay, so those who believe that the work of the Holy Spirit ended during the apostolic time, there are those who believe that. But I believe that the work of the Holy Spirit started from creation, continued in the Old Testament, in the New Testament, and even today, the work of the Holy Spirit and the function of the Holy Spirit and the role of the Holy Spirit still continues. Do you believe that? That it has not ceased. The Holy Spirit continues to be the power. The Holy Spirit continues to be the dunamis, the power. When we look at creation, in the beginning God said, and the Holy Spirit was the executor. Some people say that the Holy Spirit is the executive arm of God. Some people say that the Holy Spirit is the executive arm of God. Either way, we see that there is a working of the Holy Spirit from the time of creation. We see the work of the Holy Spirit when God called Israel. when it was just a community of tribes, we see that God touched, the Spirit of God touched Moses, came upon Moses. The work of the Holy Spirit in appointing a leader, in bringing forth a leader. We see the work of the Holy Spirit moving, the Spirit of God, also referred to as the Spirit of God, coming upon the birth of Israel with leaders like Saul and David, that it was the work of the Spirit of God that brought them to their positions, that brought them to their appointment, that gave them the enablement to be and to function in their kingly anointing. We see the role of the Holy Spirit, and it is evident in the early church. In the book of Acts, we see the work of the Holy Spirit. And on, the work of the Holy Spirit is undisputable. The birth of Jesus Christ, it was by the power of the Holy Spirit, the conception of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. We see the work of the Holy Spirit when Jesus met John the Baptist before starting his ministry. The first thing that Jesus did was to go to John the Baptist, get baptized, and what do we see? We see that the power of the Holy Spirit descended like a dove. So we keep seeing the function and the role of the Holy Spirit at a personal level, at a national level, the nation of Israel, how it came about. When we look at all the books of Kings, the wars, we see the function of the Holy Spirit, rather the Spirit of God, moving in a mighty and special way. When Jesus was about to go to heaven, around that time, he said, God is looking for those who worship the Lord, worship God in what? In? Come on, talk to me. In what? In spirit and in truth. Amen? John 14:16. Jesus says, God is looking for those who worship in spirit and in truth. So we come to an understanding that the role of the Holy Spirit is very, very important. It is critical to our existence as believers. If Jesus, in his superiority, in his power, did not start his ministry without the Holy Spirit descending from heaven, who are we to conduct our lives without the presence of the Holy Spirit, without the power of the Holy Spirit? The question is, do we really know the Holy Spirit? Do we really understand and abide in the Holy Spirit? Do we appropriate the power? Appropriating means using. Appropriating means putting to practice. Do we put to practice the power of the Holy Spirit? Do we talk to the Holy Spirit? Do we understand the doctrine of the Holy Spirit? That the Holy Spirit is a person. Do we talk to the Holy Spirit? Witchcraft and witch doctors, they talk to spirits. Sorceries and sorcerers, they talk to spirits. They are sent to torment you. They are sent to disrupt your life. They talk in that realm. Do you talk to the Holy Spirit? Jesus said that the Father is seeking those who worship in spirit and in truth. In spirit is to glorify God, is to walk in God's presence, is to appropriate everything in the spiritual realm. But in truth, it's for our benefit. It's for our benefit to understand the truth and the principles that govern you know, the day-to-day living. But that is not enough. We do need the power of God. We do need the move of the Holy Spirit to give us insight, to give us grace in the time of challenges, to give us the anointing that we need to execute, you know, those who are going to do exams. You do need the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit will remind you. The Holy Spirit will challenge you to go study if you didn't study. The purpose of understanding and appropriating the power of the Holy Spirit is not to become crazy and lazy like those people who depend on man-made miracles and all the drama in the pretext of the Holy Spirit. No. It's to understand with humility, with faithfulness in God, with wisdom in God, and with kindness to operate in the anointing of the Holy Spirit under the correct teachings and the doctrines of the Holy Spirit. So the Holy Spirit is not your magic wand. Eh? The Holy Spirit is not to be tapped into for the purpose of our own ideas of, you know, just confessions. You know, confession has its part. But you have to understand there is the element of spirit and truth. It's very important. So if we say it's not by might, it's not by power, but by the Spirit of God, we have to be in the Spirit and in truth in order to appropriate the mightiness of God and the power of God, and it will be correct when we do it within the wisdom of God and God's word. The background of the text that we were reading starts from the captivity of the Israelites. It goes back to 70 years. Nehemiah writes about it, Ezra writes about it, and Haggai writes about it. And in chapter 3, if you go back and look at chapter 3, Joshua has been dealt with by the enemy. Joshua is the high priest. The enemy has attacked him so much. The enemy has discredited Joshua. But then God redeems him. How many of you have been attacked by the enemy? How many of you right now, your life is under attack? You don't know what to do. You are challenged. Things are not happening. You are under attack, just like Joshua in chapter 3 of Zechariah. Now, chapter 4, the prophet is given information about Zerubbabel. Zerubbabel was a political figure. Zerubbabel was a leader, was a political entity, rather, representing the Israelites who were trying to come out of captivity from Babylon. So as they were coming back to Jerusalem, there were a minority that came along. And so there was a priest representing the religious figure. And then there was a political figure who was Zerubbabel. But there was a lot of other Jewish that remained in Babylon. These two were given the task to come and rebuild the temple in Jerusalem. But when they arrived, it was so much devastation. It was totally destroyed. How many of us in our lives, we are at a crossroad? Things have been destroyed. Your business, maybe your work. You are facing a lot of challenges. Mountains, huge mountains. You don't know what to do. You don't know where to go. You don't know where to start. Maybe it's your family. You don't know what to do. You don't know where to go. You don't know where to start. How many of us are experiencing demonic attacks? We may not know. We may think, oh, this is just life as usual. How many of you are probably under ancestral curses? They say, oh, I have the blood of Jesus. It's true. You're redeemed by the blood. It's true. But the enemy is working 24/7. Your enemy, like a roaring lion, like a thief, is working 24/7. So God speaks to encourage the political leader about the reconstruction of the temple in Jerusalem. This is chapter 4. This is where we were reading. Now, with very few people, very few resources, and a lot of enemies against the reconstruction of the temple, what is he supposed to do? Figure out. Think about it. Maybe you're building a house somewhere, and then you come the next morning and you find the whole house is down. Everything is messed up. Everything is destroyed. And you're trying to rebuild, but you don't have any more money. You don't have people to help you. You're all by yourself. And maybe you and a handful of sympathizers, your wife, your kids, and a few neighbors who will just look at you and say, oh, sorry, what can we do? We don't have anything. What can we? So this is the situation that Zerubbabel was going through. Limited resources, enemies who were determined to stop them from building the temple. How many of us? You're trying to rebuild your business. It's not working. You're trying to get that promotion. You have a lot of enemies. What will you do? Yes, you pray. Yes, you fast and pray. But did you ever consider, not by power, not by might, but by the Spirit of God? Turn to your neighbor and say, but by the Spirit of God. Tell them, but by the Spirit of God. Not by might can be understood as not, as might here is like force. You know, when you talk about an army, there's a force. Not by might, therefore, means that it's not the force that you may have. Sometimes we think that because we have connections, then that becomes our force. Sometimes we think that because we have, you know, people in high places, then we think that's our force. But the Bible says not by might, or not by that kind of force. Not by power. Power is necessary. Power is indispensable. Meaning indispensable, just necessary. It's essential, power. We need power. We need power to walk. We need power to do things. We need power to lift this. There are various types of power. But then power is really resources. Abundance of resources, capacity. But then the Bible says it's also not by power. Two things that we think that they might potentially solve all our problems. Might and power. But the Bible says no. That is essential. That is true. But the Spirit of God is on a different class. The Holy Spirit is on a different class. So it doesn't matter. You may have the numbers. You may have the power in an organization. You can have the resources. You can have all the methods of exercising power. But the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit, is at a different level. It's a different level. We're talking of a different type of force. We're talking about a different type of power. This is a powerful agent. Remember, just in case you forgot, God said, let there be light. And the Holy Spirit was at work. That's the Holy Spirit we are talking about this morning. Brothers and sisters, we are living in a time and age where the technology is moving so fast. We are living in a culture now that is totally denying God, a worldview that totally denies God, and a culture that is geared to make you believe that God is just a story, that the word of God is vain, that religion is the cause of problems, which is true. But we are talking about Christ. We are talking about a relationship with God. It's not about religion. But the culture of our day and the world today is so much dependent on technology and science as the power, as the force that drives everything. So regardless of all that is going on, regardless of the times that we live, we must learn to look higher, higher than all that human beings can conceive as sources of power. We must seek the power that is above all powers, and that is God. Above all cultural influences, worldviews, and various forms and levels of what is considered as truths. We must seek the ultimate truth that sets us free, the gospel, and that is our source of power and sufficiency through the enablement of the Holy Spirit. Brothers and sisters, days are coming when we really are going to need more of the Holy Spirit. We're really going to need more of the Holy Spirit. Parents, we are really going to need more of the Holy Spirit to raise children. The amount of indoctrination that is going through the cartoons that they're watching, the amount of change of mind and spirit and soul that goes on through whatever they watch on their cartoons, you will not believe it. You're gonna need the Holy Spirit to make you have. Have you ever had that feeling that I don't know English, but this cartoon, I just don't feel right about it. You say, I know they're talking. I don't get English. That's not my language. But there's something about this cartoon. I look at it and my spirit just doesn't sit right. Have you ever had that experience? How many? Show me your hands. Have you met somebody and you just looked at them and said at your office and said something about him that I just don't feel right about them. They look funny. I just don't believe them, you know. They look spooky, you know. They must be up to something. You just feel uncomfortable. You just feel the environment. Or somebody walks in and you just feel like goosebumps, like, whoa, what happened? Somebody walked in. Maybe they have stuff, you know. They've put stuff in their clothes, you know. They got extra magic, eh? and they walk in and there's a presence. How many of you have felt that? Yeah. So the days are coming when we're really going to need the Holy Spirit. Governments in the world have eyes, antennas looking, because they have to protect their countries. What about you? What eyes do you have? What extra power do you have? Have you ever known that the power of the Holy Spirit is so, so amazing, and that by the Spirit of God, we are supernaturally endowed with capacity, insight, efficiencies, and effectiveness, and the power in the sense of anointing can be seen through the following examples. Now, let's work together. I want my sister Nyanso to open the book of Exodus chapter 31, and then you're going to read verse 1 up until maybe verse 4 or 5. I'll stop you along the way. Do we have a mic? Any additional mic that they can get? Exodus chapter 1, chapter 31, verse 1 to 10. But we're going to stop anywhere. Is it there? Okay, let's, can you read it, Nyanso? Okay, where's the microphone? Come on, let's share the pulpit. Come over here, get the anointing. Oh, you're gonna read over here. I want to share the pulpit today. Okay, and then I'm going to have another person who is going to do Judges 14:6. Come over. Judges 14:6. And then I'm going to have Matthew 2:12. Matthew 2:12. Who's going to do Matthew 2:12? Come on. Come on, we need somebody. Come on, young people. Oh, yeah. Opening the Bible is a little bit challenging. Come on, let's go. Matthew 2:12. And then somebody else read Numbers 11:25. You got your verse? Matthew 2:12. Okay. And then who's going to read Numbers 11:25? Numbers 11:25. Yes, doctor, just position yourself. And then I'm going to need somebody to read 1 Chronicles 12:18. Over this side, you're looking too comfortable. Over this side, I need somebody from this side. 1 Chronicles 12:18. 1 Chronicles 12:18. Come on, Oasis. Yes, sir, thank you. 1 Chronicles 12:18, come over. All right, Luke 12, the last one, Luke 12, 11 to 12. Luke 12, 11 to 12. Come on. Anybody? This side. One more person. Come on, let's do it. Luke 12, 11 to 12. Let's go. Anybody? Pastor Deus. The people don't want to come to read the Bible. People don't want to come and read the Bible.
They're coming in red.
You know, we're gonna have to have a discussion, Oasis Church. Come on, my sister, welcome. Okay, so Luke 12, 11 to 12. Okay, everybody, you got your verses?
Yes.
We're gonna start with Nyanso.
Okay.
Exodus. Okay. Projector.
Chapter 31.
Mm-hmm.
From verse 1 up to 10.
Yes, I'll stop you anywhere, but that's the plan. Okay, go ahead.
Okay, I'll read in Jesus' name. Mm-hmm. Now the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, "See, I have called by name Bezalel, the son of Uri, the son of Huri, of the tribe of Judah. I have filled him with the Spirit of God in wisdom, in understanding, in knowledge, and in all kinds of craftsmanship."
Okay, just there. Thank you. You can have a seat. Thank you. Give her a hand, everybody. Amen. Give her a hand, everybody. Okay, we see that the Holy Spirit has filled this guy, an ordinary guy, with the power to have wisdom, understanding, knowledge, and in all craftsmanship. If we read that whole verse, Oholiab and Bezalel, they were gifted to do almost everything pertaining to designing and artistic work. That's the power of the Holy Spirit. Okay, next. Who was next? Go ahead. Yours was Judges 14:6. Go ahead. Judges 14:6, Mr. Projector. Judges 14:6.
Then it came.
Judges 14:6. Haraka, huh? Haraka, haraka.
Okay.
Go ahead.
the Spirit of the Lord came upon him mightily, so that he tore him as one tears a young goat, though he had nothing in his hand. But he did not tell his father or mother what he had done.
Thank you very much. Give him a hand. That's our upcoming preacher. Come on, give him a hand. Hallelujah. Samson tore up a lion just like a little goat. Just tore it up. A lion, bare hands. That's the Spirit of God. When the Spirit of God comes upon you, you can do amazing and wondrous things. Okay, who's next? Yes.
Matthew 2:12.
Go ahead.
It says, "And having been warned by God in a dream not to return to Herod, the Magi left for their own country by another way."
Thank you. Give her a hand, Minister Becky. Woo! All right. See, these guys, while they were sleeping, the Spirit of God comes to them and tells them, now, don't go through Mwananyamala. Go through Magomeni.
Amen.
Okay? Because the king is about to do something bad. So I'm going to tell you, go through Magomeni and not Kijitonyama. Don't you think in your day-to-day life, you're going to need this kind of secrets told to you while you're sleeping? Don't you think so? Or some people don't think, they think they need it. They look like, are you sure? Can you imagine? Somebody is planning your destruction. Somebody. Let me tell you, don't think because people are smiling at you, they're really happy for you. Most or a lot of people, in some cases, they are not. If they can have a chance to destroy you, they will. So sometimes, have you ever had an experience where you wanted to get in a certain bus and you just felt no? And then something happens and you say, oh, thank God I wasn't in that bus. Have you ever been in a situation where you were supposed to go a certain route and you said, no, I just don't feel good about it, only to find out something crazy happened there? That's when the grace of God comes. But how good would it be when we can actively involve the Holy Spirit in our day-to-day conversation to protect us, to guide us, to give us these secrets that we don't know of? Okay, next.
Numbers.
Yes.
Numbers 11:25. I'm reading from the New King James Version. Mm-hmm. Then the Lord came down in the cloud and spoke to him and took of the spirit that was upon him and placed the same upon the 70 elders. And it happened when the Spirit rested upon them that they prophesied, although they never did so again.
You see? Now, thank you, Doctor. Moses, the Spirit that was given to Moses was also apportioned to the 72 leaders. And they were able to also perform. Meaning the Spirit of God can bring you from zero to something. That's the power of the Holy Spirit. In leadership, in the national level, at work, when you're sleeping, when you're in danger, something is attacking you. The Holy Spirit, the power of the Spirit of God is so powerful. We've seen all these examples. And then, what else? Uh-huh. Go ahead.
The First Chronicles 12:18. Then the Spirit came upon Amasai, chief of the 30, and he said, "We are yours, O David. We are with you, O son of Jesse. Success to you, and success to those who help you, for your God will help you." So David received them and made them leaders in his raiding bands.
Thank you very much. Give him a hand. Thank you very much. Did you know Amasai was in the Bible? There's an Amasai. How many Masais are here? Anyway, But look, the Spirit of God can cause people to support you even though they didn't want to support you. It says, Amasai, the Spirit came upon him. He just started saying, oh, David, we're going to be with you with all my men. We're going to support you. How many of you need just a favor? People to say something about you. People to put a word for you. Maybe at work, you just want the favor. People to give you a support for you to maybe get that promotion. You know, the Spirit of God can touch somebody's heart and they just support you. They don't know you. And they just say, no, what? I don't know him, but I'm comfortable with him being the leader. I'm comfortable with him being in that position. I'm happy with this person. Even though they don't know you, they just give you full support. How many of us are in a position whereby we need people to put a word for us so that we could go to another level? The Spirit of God can touch people to support you, just like in this case. Okay, last example.
The synagogues and the magistrates and authorities, do not worry about how or what you should answer or what you should say. For the Holy Spirit will teach you in that very hour what you ought to say.
There you go. Thank you. Give her a hand. Thank you very much. That's our next preacher. Oh, hallelujah. All right. See, the Bible says the very hour, meaning, how many of you do sound and music and recording? You know, real time. Eh? In real time. The Bible says they were told, don't worry what to say. Just show up. And the Holy Spirit at that moment will give you utterance what to answer. How many of you have been in a situation where you really don't know what to say, how to say? Those who are going to interviews. You don't know what to say, you know, don't what to do. And then you ask the question, have you thought about saying, Holy Spirit, what should I answer? The Bible says the Holy Spirit can give you at that point what to answer. My brothers and sisters, as I come to the end, the power of the Holy Spirit is strongest to the degree we worship in spirit and in truth. John 4:23. The power and the move of the Holy Spirit in our lives is strongest to the degree that we worship God in spirit and in truth. That is acceptable to God. In spirit is acceptable to God. And in truth is profitable to us. So to the degree that we really go deeper into God in spirit and in truth, then we will experience all these diverse powers of the Holy Spirit.